Hi, in 1982, something really great happened. Sony introduced the very first compact disc player that a retail consumer could buy. And in 1982, that in-home CD player cost nearly $1,000. In 1984, just 2 years later, Sony introduced the very first Sony Discman, and that was the model D50. And in 1984, the Sony D50 cost $350. In the fall of 1991, Newtone introduced its very first CD player. And that was the Newtone model CD92. And this is an original CD92 player. It's not the complete CD92. It's the only part of it that I actually have. This particular one was made in 1993. So let's take a quick look at what you got when you bought a Newtone CD92 at the end of 1991. Here we have a catalog page out of a fall 1991 Newtone full-line product catalog. And on page 1.3, here we have the first time a Newtone CD92 compact disc player, because in those days nobody called them CDs much yet. They were all compact discs. And here we show in the picture, we have the CD92. It's installed in the wall below a Newtone IM4006T. It's a little hard to see here, but I'll have a better drawing of something I'll show you that might make it easier to see. What you had here was essentially a wooden cabinet. The recessed part in the wall, the black part, is all made out of wood, and it has a door that hinges down. On the front of the door is a piece of glossy black acrylic plastic. It's got a magnetic push latch here, so you would push the door and it would pop open, and then you would close it and push it and it would latch closed. On the inside of the door, you had a spot to mount the CD player itself, and over here you had sort of a little storage area where you could fit four CDs in their jewel cases. You remember jewel cases, don't you? Those are those styrene plastic cases that came with all CDs back in the day before they started to cut costs to save money. Everybody had zillions of jewel cases, and they made all those special holders that you would put them out in your listening room or in your living room or family room, and it would be stacks and stacks and stacks of jewel cases to show off your CD collection. Because to have a CD player in the early or mid 80s or even in the early 90s, they were reasonably expensive. They weren't something that everybody necessarily had. So let's look at what the catalog says about it. It says, add the option of breathtaking digital sound, crisp, clean, and smooth to any Newtone radio intercom system. Imagine enjoying your favorite CDs in any room in your house, outside at the pool or patio, wherever you have a Newtone radio intercom speaker. The compact disc player easily recesses in the wall near any Newtone radio intercom master station using the IR92 rough-in. Its attractive black finish coordinates with the black trim on the master station. Convenient front panel tilts down to reveal CD player and compartment for storing four CDs. The CD92 features include plays both 5-inch CDs and 3-inch CDs. I don't think I've ever had a 3-inch CD. CD singles, no adapter needed. Music repeat, any track or entire disc. Music repeat, any track or entire disc can be repeated. Pause button, fast forward, reverse, liquid crystal display, shows total tracks and time of your compact disc. Identifies tracks you select and shows time elapsed for track. Frequency response 20 Hz to 20,000 Hz, harmonic distortion of 0.05%. In 1992, if you bought the CD92 option to go along with your Newtone 4006 or maybe a 3003, retail price for the CD92 player assembly, the trim out, and the rough in together was $584, which was quite a lot of money. And you can imagine that it's not something that most people really stepped up and bought. I think in the time that it was available, which was a fairly short amount of time, they only made it for about 4 years. I think I installed probably a couple dozen of them. Those were in big expensive homes where cost was really not the issue. For a lot of people, $584. Even if you were a really good customer and you got 20% off, it was still a lot of money to spend on a compact disc player. So here we have a copy of the original operating instructions that would have come with a CD92. Compact disc player model CD92. Warning, do not expose this product to moisture. CD players don't like moisture, so you can't get them wet. You have controls and indicators, and we have 1 through 12, and it describes what all of the different functions on this are. You have to remember that this was still a fairly new thing in 1991, not something that everybody had, so you have to explain to people what it was and how to use it. We turn over to page 2. We have the operation instructions, and it explains how to use it. We have some explanation as to what's on the liquid crystal display. Here we have care and maintenance. It points out the lens. Is there a lens warning? Usually there's a lens warning of some type, because if it gets scratched, it won't work properly. And down here we have our specifications. Tracking system, 3-beam laser. None of that 1 or 2-beam laser rubbish. 3 beams, obviously the way to go. Laser pickup is a semiconductor laser. 18-bit linear digital audio converter. Frequency response 20 to 20,000 hertz. Harmonic distortion 0.08 at 1 kilohertz. Signal to noise ratio 90 dB. So on and so on. Wow and flutter below measurable limit. No wow and flutter. It's not a record player. It's not a cassette. It's a CD. Output terminals, phones jack, which are headphones. Output jack, both 3.5 millimeter. DC in, 5.5 millimeter jack. It's all pretty standard for CD players back in those days. Here we have laser safety warning. It's a class 1 laser product. This unit employs a laser. Only qualified service persons to remove the cover to attempt service of this device due to possible eye injury. And yes, when you work on CD players, if you're going to have the unit operational, you are supposed to wear a special pair of goggles that protects your eyes in case you get zapped with the laser. Caution, use of controls, adjustments, or performance of procedures other than specified herein results in hazardous radiation exposure. And what they're meaning are CD players all inherently have a lot of safety devices built into them so that the laser doesn't turn on without a CD in place or with the cover or door open, because again, they don't want anybody going blind. And here we have the installation instructions, and this kind of shows the layout a little better than the tiny picture in the catalog. So what we have here is, here's our IR92 rough-in cut into the wall. Down here is the power supply. It's a low voltage transformer with a little DC board on it. And here we have our storage box. This is the part that's made out of wood. These slots right here are where your CD jewel cases fit. And right here on the back of the door is where your CD player Velcros in place. Shows the mounting screws. There's an audio cable and a transformer cable. And here it shows the proper positioning for your 6 strips of Velcro that you attach to the back of the CD player and then stick it onto the door. And hopefully you get it straight and square with the door. It's not crooked, because then the lady's gonna complain, "Hey, that looks crooked." It's like, no, it's not, it's fine. And when you peel it off, then you gotta try to get it done again. It wasn't that much of a problem, but it was a little bit on the hokey side. Here we have the parts sheets list for the CD92. You have the CD92 cabinet, you have the door assembly. You could actually order the door separately. One of the problems with this, again, this is all made out of wood. So the little holders for the jewel cases, these had a tendency to snap off the inside of the door because it was just glued in place. So that was a problem. You could get the latch. The CD player was a complete assembly, no parts for it. If you had a broken one, you have to get a replacement for it. You have the wall housing, transformer can, and bracket. These are not parts you could order separately. The wall housing is the same wall housing that's used for intercom master stations. It would be an IR105 sized can, but the transformer is different. And you can buy the little rectifier board here that attaches to it. And this is a fairly clever design. I'm going to show you that. And we flip back here. We have all of our Newtone part numbers, again, an illustration about how to place the Velcro, and so on and so on. So this is all from back in the day. I pulled this out of an old binder that I used to keep this kind of stuff in when it would come from Newtone, and we'd file it away in case I needed to look something up. The reason I'm finally able to make this video is because of this. This is the transformer and little rectifier board that came with an IR92. While I had the CD player for a long time, sitting on the shelf in my office, I didn't have one of these. And sure, I could have put something together with my bench power supply and found a proper plug-in and wired it up, but that's not really the point. That doesn't make a good video. You need to have most of the bits and pieces. Someday I'll find a cabinet, then I can have a complete one. This is a Newtone 515 low voltage transformer. In fact, I think it's a 515. Let's open it up. Let's take it apart and see. Yes, it is a Newtone 515, which is 10 volts at 5 watts, or 5 VA for modern people. And what they did here to make this a simple assembly, they used these little metal spacers, which sit on the secondary side on the screw terminals, and then the board is designed to sit over them. Like this. And then you put the little bit longer than average screws through them. And that screws it all together. It's a clever design. It's a quick and easy way to do it. The little board wouldn't have cost very much at all to have made. And I imagine they didn't have to make very many of them because I don't think they sold a lot of CD players. So all we have on here is 4 diodes to build a full-wave bridge rectifier. We have a little bit of filtering going on. There's nothing fancy about this. It's just a little rectified power supply board. Changes AC into DC to run our CD player. So let's look at our CD player real quick. This is the CD92 player itself. It says compact disc digital audio, compact disc player, CD92. It says Newtone down here. You have an open button, which pops open the door. This one doesn't pop open quite as well as when it was brand new, but it's not too bad. And there's also a lock button on it, I suppose, because if it was on the sitting on the door like this, and then you were to close the door, it would tip up like this, and you wouldn't want the door to flop open, and then the CD would fall out, so you can lock it so it won't do that. On the back, you have your DC in jack, and it specifies DC in 9 volts. It will actually operate on between 6 and 9 volts. Here we have a power on-off switch. We have a line out. We have headphone out. And we have a volume control. The volume control controls the headphone out. The line out is just line out. It's a fixed level. Here on the front, we have our LCD liquid crystal display right here. We have our controls. We have stop, play and pause, fast forward, and rewind. You also have a repeat button here, so you can have it repeat one song over and over, or you can repeat the whole CD over and over. There is no shuffle play. Shuffle is a Sony term. Shuffle play plays the songs in a random order, and none of those features like that. And if you look at this, this is very much like the form factor of an early Sony Discman, because I'm pretty sure everybody copied everyone else on the best way to build something like this. This is basically just a portable CD player that's been sort of reshuffled a little bit to fit inside of the Newtone cabinet. Did Newtone design the CD92 player? No, I don't think that they did. I know that these were built in Japan, and they were built by a company called Funai. And Funai is the same company that built the circuit boards for a 4006 master station. They didn't build the boards for 3003s. Those came from somewhere else. But I know that they did do all of the boards for 4006s through its entire production. They also manufactured the CD92. And I'm pretty sure that this is a variation of a fairly standard model that they would have had back in the day, and perhaps they made some modifications to it, or they had a selection of features and things that you could choose from to suit your price point, and private labeled it as a Newtone item, and out the door they went. This particular CD92 has been in the collection in the museum for quite a long time. I don't recall where I got it from. It probably came from an installation that we did an upgrade on or something like that, and the customers didn't want it anymore. And of course, we're not going to throw it away because there's nothing actually wrong with it. This one actually does work. At least I think it does the last time I tried it. Most of these at this point they don't work anymore. And unfortunately, there is no repair on these because there are no parts or assemblies for them any longer. And the odds of finding parts to fix something like this are very slim at this point, since this was made such a long time ago. Now, I've never actually opened one of these up. Back when these were current, when you would have a customer with a problem, you would have Newtone Parts Department send out a warranty replacement, and you would just swap it out and then send the defective one back to Newtone. I don't think Newtone repaired them either. I'm pretty sure they probably got thrown in a bin somewhere, and eventually they all got thrown out, because repairing CD players, as I've talked about in other videos, is a very complex thing, and it's probably not worth the time or trouble for what one of these probably actually cost. So let's go ahead and open this up. I'm not going to do a complete teardown on it because it is a functional unit and I really don't want to ruin it. And if you start taking something like this apart too much, you may never get it back together again the way it was, and then it may not work again, and I would rather have a working unit. So we're just going to take the four screws off the bottom and see if the bottom comes off. There isn't really a lot inside of a CD player to look at. Usually you have a primary circuit board, you have the laser drive assembly, so we'll take that off, and we have some metal shielding here and some ground wires. So let's go ahead and take the screw for the ground wires off. Move those out of the way. Lift the shield. And here we have pretty much what you would expect to see. A wide variety of integrated circuits. See if we can see who these were made by. Oh, surprisingly enough, that one says Sony. That one says Sony, that one says Sanyo. This one's upside down, it's mooning all of us. And probably all of the electrons are gonna fall out of it. Maybe that's why these didn't work so well sometimes. Not supposed to put the chips in upside down. It doesn't readily seem to want to come out. And I'm not really gonna force it. I don't see, it feels as if there's something holding it in place in the center. So we're just going to leave it at that because, like I said, I don't really want to break it. One of the things that's interesting, especially on early CD players like this, are there's a variety of trim pots on the board. There's one here, 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 here. And there were, in early CD players, there was a lot of little bit of tweaking that would go on to adjust it correctly so it would play properly. There's also an adjustment here and here I see. That might be one also. It's very small opening, so it's a little bit hard to see. Each one would be hand adjusted. And of course, they're using Sony CD chipsets. I wouldn't be surprised if that was a Sony part also, because, you know, Sony's the one who invented CD players, so who would have better chipsets for them than the original designer? Okay, so I know you'll want to see it. I figured out the board does come out. It has interconnect assemblies here, 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 and here, and they plug into receptacles inside on the mechanism. Oddly enough, I hypothesized that this would also be a Sony chip, but actually, if we turn it around and look at it, what does it say on it? Can you see it? It says Funai. That's the manufacturer. This is a Funai board, and it is a Funai design chip. Either that, or it's another brand, could be a Sony chip, and they bought enough of them that they labeled them as Funai. Although, I don't see why they would have done that if they use Sony chips on this side. The other thing that's interesting about this, since this was designed in the, would be the early 90s, it's all through-hole parts, no surface mount parts, except for the integrated circuits, the chipsets. Everything else is still through-hole, and that would have been done primarily to save money, because it was less costly to make that way. Our little LCD screen here is attached to the board, and odds are that this Funai chip is the LCD driver chip for the display. If we look here on the inside, we have our front panel with the buttons that slides off. It's upside down, goes this way. And in here, we have what is most likely the audio board down here, a little single inline IC package here. Back here, we have a little bit of a power supply, regulation board, probably a voltage regulator, and another voltage regulator. And here is our CD drive assembly. This is the sled assembly. This is the part that slides back and forth. You have a threaded rod here, and you have a stepper motor that turns it very slowly and incrementally moves the laser diode across to read the surface of the CD. This has actually got a little belt right here. So it's not a gear drive, it's a little belt drive. Seems to be pretty well intact. Hopefully it doesn't break, because belts are getting harder and harder to find nowadays. So that's the inside of our CD92 player. Oh, the other thing which is interesting is, if we open it up like this, the CD drive assembly, this part, it's all spring mounted. You can see the springs, see it move? There are spring points here and here and here, there's three of them, so it gives it a little bit of bounce, so it wouldn't cause, if you close the door or move the door or something like that, the theory would be that it wouldn't make the CD player skip. When early CD players first came out in 1982, one of the real problems and one of the real complaints with them were that they would tend to skip quite a bit. The designs of CD players changed after that to make them less prone to skipping, because it was really annoying if you'd walk across a room or something like that, or the kids would run through the family room and the CD player would skip on the song. There were a lot of changes that happened. Now I'm going to go ahead and put it back together. So I've got the CD92 put back together. It was actually fairly easy to do. If we go ahead and turn the power on, I've got it plugged into the power supply. You can see the liquid crystal display light up. And then if we go ahead and open it up and we pop a CD in, there are no catches on the CD player hub assembly. It just sits in there, and then it's got the springy hub on the top of the lid that presses down and holds it in place. So we'll close the door and lock it. You don't have to lock it if you don't want to. And it spins up and it shows us that the CD that I put in has 12 tracks, and total play time is 47 minutes and 29 seconds. And if we press play, it will begin to play. I don't have it hooked up to anything yet. We can also pause, and you can see the play arrow blinks. And if we press repeat, it'll say one repeat. And if we push it again, it says all for all repeat. Third press goes back to standard play. You can fast forward through the song. And if you press it once quickly, you can skip to the next track. Now, it doesn't explain that in the operating instructions, which I find is interesting. Perhaps it was an oversight in the instructions, or perhaps it was a change in the CD player design along the way. I don't really see how you could have a CD player you couldn't change tracks on. That would be kind of silly. It's not a cassette tape, after all that fast-forwarding and rewinding you have to do. And I suppose you can track back also. And yes, you can. So that's our little CD92. Of course, No video would be complete without at least a little bit of playtime. So let's see what we can do about that. All right, so here's our setup. What could be more appropriate to test our CD92 than with a 4006? Now, I didn't have a 4006 traditional, the brown and black one, like they show in the catalog, but I do have this really nice, totally refurbished white one that I own. It seems like an appropriate choice. I suppose if you were going for a black and white theme in your house, you could get by with the black, glossy CD92 door with a nice white 4006 master station, and you'd be the bomb. You'd have it all going on. You've got radio, you've got intercom, you've got a built-in cassette player, and you have the latest fad and craze, which are CD players. You have it all going on. All you have to do is tie it into your VCR, so when you watch movies, you can hear it through the house, and you're all set. Let's go ahead and press play and see what we get. Now, The audio connection is in the Phonos jack, and so it's controlled by the volume control here on the side, so you can adjust the level, because as I recall correctly, the playback level on early CDs was a little bit all over the place, and I suppose that's why they gave you that. Seems like an appropriate song choice. It just happened that way. Because from Small Things, your CD92, big things did come. And the big thing that came after it was the IMA4406. And the IMA4406 was the first Newtone radio intercom master station that had the CD player built into it. And it was all the thing. I remember when they first came out, we could not install them fast enough. So that's a little bit of an overview of a Newtone CD92 in-wall compact disc player from 1991, or this one from 1993. This could very well be possibly the last CD92 in the whole entire planet that still works. Maybe somebody else has one that does work. If you do, put it in the comments down below. Let me know if you still use it or not. I hope you found this interesting and perhaps helpful. If you did, please give it a big thumbs up on YouTube because that always helps. There'll be a banner right here that shows you how to subscribe. Go to our YouTube homepage, click on the bell or on the wheel, put in your email address, and every time we post a new video, you'll get a notification and you can watch it. That's all for today. See you on the next video.